Breaking love was made for me and you. Hello and welcome to Art and Soul. I'm your host, Caroline Jones. Here in Nashville at the SiriusXM Studios, his name is Mac McAnally. He is in the Nashville Songwriters Hall of Fame, and he is an 8-time consecutive CMA Musician of the Year, which, if you're not a country music fan listening right now, to be CMA Musician of the Year in Nashville is a big, big reason. He has written songs and produced for Jimmy Buffett, Kenny Chesney, Sawyer Brown, Alabama, Restless Heart, I love that band, Ronnie Dunn, Steve Warner, Zach Brown Band, and he has been a session player, an acoustic guitar session player on George Strait, Martina McBride, Dolly Parton, George Jones, Billy Joel, Reba. It would honestly take me all day to read the list. And I'm almost done. He's a very humble guy, so I know he's blushing right now. So he is in the Nashville Songwriters Hall of Fame, and he's an 8-time consecutive CMA Musician of the Year, which, if you're not a country music fan listening right now, to be CMA Musician of the Year in Nashville is a big, big deal because Nashville has the best players on earth.
Well, it's a lot of luck, you know. Our standard line is I'm the third best guitar player in my band, so there's a certain amount of luck involved in that as well.
And that band is the Coral Reefer Band, Jimmy Buffett's longtime band, and Mac has been, we're going to get into your relationship with Jimmy Buffett, but you have been his songwriting partner, his producer, his right-hand man for many, many decades now, right?
It is true, yes. I'm from the Paleozoic folk period. Well, my mom was a gospel piano player in the church growing up, and she played every church service, and then, you know, weddings and funerals and all day singings. That's what we call them in Mississippi. And so I was always.
What is an all day singing?
An all day singing is just where people go. People gather at usually a church because there's a piano there, but sometimes they would lug one out to a cemetery, and it would be part of a decoration or an honoring of the people that have passed, family members and family reunions and that sort of stuff. But everybody would carry their songbooks and just literally sit and sing all day, and there would be, so consequently, we entertained ourselves with music. Our neighbors would maybe three nights a week would all wander over to our house and bring whatever instrument they had, and it didn't have to fit together. It did, you know, it could be a dulcimer and a saxophone and a piano, just literally the biblical joyful noise.
Mm.
People would bring whatever they could make a noise with.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's been a lot of great music recorded in Muscle Shoals. It's sort of known as the R&B center, you know, Wilson Pickett and Aretha Franklin, but honestly, so many people, the Rolling Stones came there, and they did Brown Sugar and Wild Horses
and, yeah.
and that's the place has some little magic about it. Maybe because of where it is on the river, that's what the Indians believe. But anyway, there's, for whatever reason, there were a bunch of great players that came from there. Sam Phillips, that started Sun Records and signed Elvis, he was a Muscle Shoals guy before he went to Memphis. It would be Aretha Franklin one day, and it would be Willie Nelson the next day, and it would be the Oak Ridge Boys the next day, and then, you know, then Phil Collins the next day, Bob Dylan the next day. And they just said, Bob Seger did all the classic, you know, old time rock and roll and night moves and that stuff, you know, that was done down in Muscle Shoals as well. And they just looked at it like, hey, this guy's cool. Look, we're going to make the best record we can make on this guy. It never was, let's put a R&B hat on, or let's put a country hat on. It's just a desire to make music as good as you can make it.
Well, it sounds like it's embedded in the culture there from what you said about your upbringing, of those all-day sing-alongs.
Oh, yeah, it really is.
Versatility of instruments.
And
how did you get into that culture of being a session player, being kind of a first-call acoustic session player down there? Because that's a big deal how old were you, 15, 16?
I was a teenager, yes. And they had great players, but they didn't really have a dedicated acoustic guitar player. And as people, I played in church, and then I played in State Line honky-tonks right above Muscle Shoals.
When you were a kid?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
That's an education.
At the same time, yes.
Right.
And my family's very religious. They would never have gone to a State Line honky-tonk, but
right.
They wanted me to be a musician. And this guy came to our house in Mississippi and made a big presentation to my parents. You know, I want your son to play in my band at this bar. And I thought they were going to throw him out. And he said, you know, you want him to be a player? I'm a good Christian man. I'll look after him. I won't let him get in trouble. I'll come pick him up and I'll bring him back. And I was 13. And, and I will pay him $250 a week. And somewhere in that presentation.
Right, I'm guessing it was the last
it's
part.
It's possibly the last part, but that Friday night I was on a stage in a lime green leisure suit playing songs I'd never heard on piano before. And that was the beginning of me being a honky-tonk player. But the Muscle Shoals session players, that's where they went to relax and play, because Muscle Shoals was a dry county. You couldn't buy a beer. And so the places where speakeasies where musicians would normally cut their chops playing in a band, they didn't exist in Muscle Shoals. These guys were just inherently good. But when they wanted to play live, they had to go up to the Tennessee Line. And I met those guys up there. You know, I was playing in mediocre country bands, but I was afraid to get off the stage because these were rough places. I mean, really rough places, like people rev up chainsaws instead of applaud and that sort of thing. And when we took a break, I was the piano player, but when we took a break, I would pull out an acoustic guitar and sit on the. I didn't even get off the stage because
right.
I was afraid, you know. And,
right.
And
you
I would
want
sit
to stay
around
behind the guitar.
I would stay behind the piano and the guitar,
right.
and just sit back there and play during the break. And I met the Muscle Shoals guys during the breaks of our gigs at the State Line, and they were like, "Hey, you should come and play with us sometime." And they started.
You know, Mac, when I listen to your lyrics, the depth of them as a message always comes through to me and touches me. And you've talked a lot about in interviews and what I've read, you've talked a lot about the importance of narrative in your lyrics, storytelling, and you've even said that some of your major influences are writers.
Or more literary prose, yes.
Yeah. So can you tell us your process of writing, and is a thread of morality is the wrong word, but kind of life lessons or wisdom, is that important to you when you're writing? Because it seems to be a thread in your music.
Well, you know, I probably hesitate to call it as much as an aspect of the way I try to live life.
Mm.
When I figure something out, or mistakenly think I figured something out about life, I tend to put that in a more memorable form, and songs are that service for me. Came about to try to make myself a better person, and I don't have any moral judgments for anybody else. I want to be better. I want to be a better dad and a better neighbor and a better American and a better guitar player. I want to constantly get better.
But also, as a music fan, there's something very satisfying and poignant about expressing a truth that you found in
Absolutely.
A lyric. Even more profound and poignant and true than telling someone else's story or even recounting your own experience. There's something about then alchemizing that experience into a nugget of wisdom and putting it in a song. That's the highest calling of an artist.
I agree with you, and you do that well, let me say.
Oh, thank you. So what is your writing process like now? How has it changed? Because, you know, I'm still in my probably second decade of writing, and you're mm-hmm. in your, what?
I guess fifth.
Fifth.
Yeah.
So tell us how it's changed or how it stayed the same. Is your writing process still, you know, is inspiration still as kind of fleeting and
sure.
magical as it was in the beginning?
And I see it as magical. And you know, I've got my friends here in Nashville that are more traditional Nashville songwriters. They come to town with a blank notepad, and they ride in the morning knowing that there's going to be a song that doesn't exist, that they have no concept of at this point, mm-hmm. when they go home this afternoon. And there's a satisfaction in that from a workman standpoint, from a craftsman standpoint. I've never been very successful at that type of writing, although I have a high
regard. Right, you can't just sit down and say, okay, now it's time.
Now we're writing a song.
Right.
I've always looked at it as magical because I've never understood it. The very first songs just literally fell out of my mouth in the amount of time it takes to play them. That's how long it took to write them.
Mm-hmm.
And I still honestly schedule my life like I'm not a songwriter. And I sort of demand of inspiration that it interrupt me.
Mm.
And consequently, I've not written as many songs as most people my age have written.
When inspiration has that compelling
yes.
energy to it, that's the special stuff. At least
and it lives on in the songs.
Yes.
It does live on in the songs.
And you really can't take credit for that, you're right.
No, I don't want to take credit for it.
I mean, not you in particular, but anyone, because I've felt that too, and you really... couldn't think that up in a normal state of consciousness.
No,
you
that's
know?
Right. I have a few songs that are better than me. You know,
right.
And I have, you know,
which is a beautiful thing.
It is a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
So I made this first record, and we went to Los Angeles, got a record deal. Even believe it or not, the way I talk, I got a pop record deal in the 70s during the disco.
You got a pop record deal?
I had a pop record deal. Golly. I was wearing my grandfather's overalls. I've never been on a plane.
Oh, my God.
My family broke out into prayer groups and began to worry whether the plane was going to crash on the way out there or whether people in L.A. would kill me just because I was, you know, there. And wrote me a note and said, we're both from Mississippi. We're both storytellers. We're going to be friends. I'm going to sing some of your songs.
We will be friends.
And we'll make send me this note and meant what he said. We serve each other well in that way, because you know, some of my long attention detail helps him in the record making process, stuff that's tedious to him, and his five ideas every 5 minutes, two of them being amazing, serves me very well because I don't have that many ideas.
Right.
You know, I don't have the nonstop brain that he has, and so it's a good combo. I just believe it's important to do your best, to always do your best. Doesn't matter what you're doing.
Mm.
And I figured this out. For me particularly, I got it figured out. I was working on a highway, a terrible job. Just and most jobs suck to some degree, you know, but this, I was widening a highway in North Mississippi, and I was digging a ditch along beside the highway, and it was the middle of summer. And I was telling everybody that would listen to me that it sucked, you know, and then I just sort of said, well, it's my job. I'm gonna go do the best I can do and see what happens. And I came up with my personal theory that even in a job that sucks, doing your best is the shortest path to a job that sucks less.
That is so true.
And you should know that. You shouldn't just toss off work and a job because it's not exactly what you want to be doing. There's something to be learned from everything. There's something to be improved by everything.
Yeah, and a lot of people think if I make the best of this, then maybe I'll, you know, settle for it. Then I'll get kind of complacent in it. But the opposite is true.
No, it's absolutely the opposite. Yeah. And I have, for me, the best job in the world now. And it's sort of a result of looking at a bunch of jobs that weren't as cool as this with a positive attitude, I think.
And so last but not least, you wrote with Zach Brown and
yes,
some of the members of the Zach Brown Band. And I remember this song on their second record, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
Uncaged?
Yes, I think
is that,
yeah.
Is that it? And that's a great record. And I'm a big Zach Brown fan. I know you are too.
We sort of hit it off as friends and got to pick a little bit together. And he just says, come out on the road, you know. You can get up and play on stage, and we'll sit up after the shows and we'll write songs in the bus. It's very old school, even though they're a modern band. Their approach is old school, and they're just literally eaten up with music. I mean, they play a 3-hour show, and then while they're tearing down the gear, they set up and play in the venue somewhere else. They let the crew guys get up and play songs, and then when it's all packed up and they're going to the next town, they sit up and play on the bus.
No way.
And that's what they do. You know, that's how they tour. And it was good rejuvenation for me because I've been such a studio rat for a while, and Zach and I were on the bus together, and you tend to talk about what you have in common. And obviously we're both guitar players, and he's a great singer, you know, and we had a lot of things in common, but we have daughters. I've got 3 daughters, and Zach has, well, he's passed me quite a bit with kids now. He finally had his first son. I think he's got 4 girls and a boy now. Both said, you know, even as you say, your family's the most important thing in the world. Sometimes the most important things in your life get put to the back of the line. And it's something we got to remind ourselves of all the time, because nothing is not important.
So tell us about With a Straight Face and why the song means so much to you and how you came to write it.
Well, where I grew up, for me, my little hometown, wonderful little community, really, really sweet, wonderful people. It was sort of like Mayberry, if you ever watched the Andy Griffith Show. And I was kind of Opie. I was a little redheaded. I didn't know my hair was red because he had it cut so short, but when it grew out a little bit, it was really red. And at any rate, it was a wonderful, idyllic place for me to grow up. And as we grew up and as we became teens, I had a couple of my friends, turns out, happened to be gay, and they didn't have the same experience as me. It was not as wonderful, and it was not as idyllic. And these wonderful, compassionate neighbors that I grew up with, that wrapped me in the arms of this beautiful community, didn't necessarily wrap my friends up, or they felt compelled to hide their nature. And it's not something I've ever really heard songs about, and I didn't set out to break any ground. I just look back at myself and my friends and see how maybe I could have done things better, and maybe I could have been a better friend, and this song came from that. But it has a little, we tend to say songs have juice in them or not. This song has a little juice in it for something I'm pleased to have been a part of it. But it's an unusual topic for a song. I've always had a heart for anybody that's oppressed in any way. And this is a song for my friends. I don't want to say an apology, but at least a pledge to do better.
This song is a song that you recorded early on in your career.
Yes.
And it kind of came back and had another life a few years ago when Kenny Chesney cut it. And you were on the song with him.
It was written on an early Christmas morning, late Christmas Eve, ever how you would view that, but I was doing some of the no assembly required things that dads do sometimes on a Christmas Eve, and it was unusually warm in Alabama, and somewhere around 3 in the morning I discovered I had to go get some D batteries, and I chased batteries down, and I was wide awake even though it was time to be asleep, and I had a couple of hours left before my kids got up and looked under the tree. And I just started thinking about the family and what it means particularly to me and how much my kids mean to me. And then myself and how much I meant to my parents. I kind of got a picture of the family going in both directions, forward and backwards. And sat down on the porch, and this song sort of fell out. You know, as we said earlier, it fell out of my mouth. You know, I can't really say it was written literally 21 years later than that. Kenny Chesney is a good friend, and I got to give him a little props because we're sitting here looking at the Ryman. We're looking at the mother church of country music straight out the window here. But Kenny calls me on the phone, and he says, what are you doing tomorrow? And I said, nothing, because I'm honest that way. And he said, well, come over to the studio, and let's fool around. I said, what are we going to do? And he said, we're going to cut one of your songs, and I don't care which one. And I've been writing songs a long time. As you said earlier, I've been writing them so long that they somehow or other stuck me into the Songwriters Hall of Fame down the street. And nobody has ever said that to me. We're going to cut one of your songs.
It doesn't matter.
I don't care which one.
Yeah, that is rare.
I took that as a compliment. And when it's somebody like Kenny, who's a big deal, and he's a great guy as well. But for a songwriter, that's a big thing to hear somebody say. So I go over to the studio the next day, and you know, thinking this is going to be cool, you know, and I walk in, and there's not a band there. There's just my friend Eric Darkin beating on a wooden box, and Kenny sitting there, and his engineer, and Buddy Cannon, the producer, just four guys in the studio. And Kenny said, well, you know, what do you want to sing? I know a bunch of your songs. And I said, it doesn't matter to me. I know a bunch of my songs, too. and he said, well, I don't have any kids of my own, Mac, but someday, if I ever do, I want to tell my kids what you told your kids in that song down the road. He said, let's sing that. You sing the second verse, and we'll make it a duet. And you know, in this business of sort of rocket science record making that we live in today, that's just such a weird thing to have happened. And Eric beat on a wooden box, and I played the guitar, and Kenny and I sang it. We sang it about three or four times, literally, and high-fived each other and walked out of the studio. And I remember thinking that day, you know, that sounds pretty good. I think if it didn't have me on it, it might even be a hit, you know. And it turns out I underestimated the star power of Kenny Chesney, because he was able to have a hit even with me on it. He dragged me all the way up the charts like an ankle weight. and we had a number one and a Grammy nomination, and many cool things came from it, you know. But my favorite thing of all those wonderful things is still the way it felt Christmas morning sitting out on the porch in Alabama, thinking about what I was thinking about and what I'm thinking about again right now. This song does it for me over and over again.
Yeah, it's a goosebumper for sure.
Calm down a little.
When I